morning. Good morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I would like for you to turn to your neighbors, to your left and right, and just tell them, what a joy to see you today. So we start with our notices. Please take note of the calendar events in your bulletin. We have an estimate of about 14 events scheduled between November and January. And I say an estimate because, of course, in between, we have so many other activities. So we have a fun-filled time ahead. And just to name a few, the Salad Supper is November 20th. The Christmas Fair, December 2nd. Toy Service and Choir Concert, December 10th. And the Candlelight Service, December 17th. Now, for the Salad Supper, we can all be of great help. We can do this by donating dessert and any delicious items for the auction table. And I know we are capable of making delicious items here at Ebenezer, right? So if you want to donate any of these, please speak to Mrs. Paulette Humes. Now, the Christmas Fair. I gave the date, but keep this in mind. That's 32 days away, okay? That's not far at all. Okay, let's all get involved, and we can do this by donating supplies, or we can give monetary donations for supplies. We can even help stall holders and assist in so many ways. So let's all get involved for the Christmas Fair. On Saturday, November 11th, is our jumble sale. And starting tomorrow, Monday, and then Tuesday and Saturday from 10 to 12, we will be sorting clothes and various items to start preparing for the jumble sale. So if you have any time available, please feel free to come out this week to help. This then leads me to my next point. For our youth department, we have a number of activities lined up for this week, especially for those who are on midterm break or ending that break, or anyone of any age who may have free time. We will be helping as well with the jumble sale as part of our activities. Tomorrow at 9:45 a.m. to 4 p.m., our youth can be dropped here to the hall. Not only will they help, they'll also be doing pillow making, watching short films, having Bible discussion, and different studies. Tuesday, we will help with the jumble sale, and on Thursday, we have a trip to the Bahamas Association for the Physically Disabled. Okay, and so you would be dropped to the hall at 9:30 and collected at 1:45. Anyone is welcome to help. If you would like to donate any food for the lunch this week for our youth, or any nice treats for us to carry down to the association, please feel free to do so. The position of front office secretary is now being offered as a full-time position. That's 9 to 4, Monday to Friday. And this position must be filled within 2 weeks. So if you are interested, or if you know anyone that is interested, please see Reverend Milton Lightborn. Adult Sunday School will resume next Sunday, November 5th, 9:45, right here. Now, as we continue to keep each other in prayer, be mindful of those listed in the bulletin in need of special prayer. Also, remember our very own Reverend Milton Lightborn and his wife, Dr. Lightborn. Their granddaughter, Kali, is still in hospital, and they are in need of our prayers. And so far, they've been so grateful for the prayers that have gone up. We also extend condolences to the Donzel U. George Claire family. Let us keep them in prayer. As we continue to support and help each other, keep in mind that Deacon Audrey Scabella's Medical Fund cookout is coming up November 11th, 12 to 5 p.m. at R.M. Bailey Park. please purchase tickets from Reverend Milton Lightborn. Bible study with prayer meeting will continue, and it will be held Tuesday at 6:30. Now, our favorite time, at least my favorite time, birthday time, right? Celebrating birthdays this week would be Debbie Walker, Nelson Woodside Jr., Carmen Vargas, Tanya Ward, Frida Hall, Janae Seymour. Did we miss anybody out? Great. So let us sing happy birthday as we celebrate. Okay, as we continue into our worship, I ask for everyone to please stand. Together, we will say our responsive call to worship. Almighty God, through the love of your Son, you opened the way of eternal life to every race and nation by the promised gift of your Holy Spirit. Let us spread this gift throughout the world by our love for one another, that it may reach to the ends of the earth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Come, let us worship the God from whom all blessings flow and who dwells with us today.
This is our God, worthy of our worship, whom we will praise.
We will praise the one who lives and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit. One God forever and ever. Amen. As we continue to lift our voices in praise, let us sing our opening hymn. Come, let us all unite and sing. Hymn number 22.
Thank you.
Together, let us share in the reading of the modern creed. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as a divine presence in our lives and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. As we prepare our hearts for the pastoral prayer, which will be done by Mr. Earl Pinder, we will sing and meditate on our prayer chorus, "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior," printed in our bulletins.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come again to you this morning to worship and to praise you. And as we gather here together, Lord, we are reminded of all your past goodness to us. You have kept us all safe to meet in this place at this time. And so we come recognizing your power, your greatness, and recognizing the love that you have for each of us, your children. And through that love, you send your Son, Jesus, into our world to live like one of us and then to offer his life as a sacrifice for the sin of all mankind. So we give you thanks, Lord, for providing for all of our daily needs. And as we come, Lord, we are conscious that we have not always done or said those things we should. And so we ask for your forgiveness. And Lord, help us to forgive others that may have wronged us. This morning, Lord, we remember those who have special needs. There are some from our own congregation who are sick, and we especially remember Reverend Lightburn and Mrs. Lightburn's granddaughter. We thank you for the improvement she made and pray you would continue to touch her with your hand of healing. And Lord, we remember those who mourn the death of loved ones. And we pray, Lord, that you would be a source of comfort and strength during this time. And Lord, we remember our church, our own church here at Ebenezer. We pray you would be with all those who couldn't be with us today for some reason. But we remember the wider church of our conference throughout our islands, and the even wider church throughout our world, that you would be with each of them, and especially in areas where there is violence, where there's war. We especially remember the people in Israel and Gaza and the people in the Ukraine. And Lord, we pray that in some way you may be able to bring peace, not only there, but to our whole world. And now as we have this time of worship and fellowship together, we pray that you would be with each one who takes part, and may all that we do or say be done to bring further honor and glory to your name. For we pray in the name of Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
We will now sing our offertory hymn, O Love, How Great Thou Art, number 434. Followed by this, Mr. Dariano Stubbs will come and lead our offertory prayer. Please stand on the last verse.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Let us pray. Father God, as we give thanks and praise for all you have done and all you're still about to do, we say thank you. Father, we ask you bless these gifts and the givers. We ask for your continued guidance, love, and protection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It is time for a children's chat. And so, as I ask the children, our youth, to make their way to the front, we will sing I Am So Glad, hymn number 421. So make your way down here to the altar.
Thank you.
Good morning again. Oh, y'all sound good and awake. All right, then just something I forgot to mention up there. If you didn't see the flyer, if you're coming tomorrow, please let me know today so that we can sign you up for lunch. And you can bring your pillows, your blankets, everything you need, because we have a full day of comfortable study, prayer, and volunteer work, okay? Great. 9:45 until 4 p.m. tomorrow. Full day. Okay. Now, I will ask a few questions, so raise your hand if you want me to come to you. No shouting out answers, okay? Can somebody name, or anybody, name one thing, good thing, that you like people to do for you? Or actually, let me ask differently. Do you like people to do good things for you? Yes? Oh, you all light up when I ask that. Good. Okay, now raise your hand if you want to name one good thing that you like for people to do for you. Oh, keep people safe. I like that one. To help you be saved. Okay. For people to always be good. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Pardon? Give you money? All right. That's fine. You gotta be honest. Anyone else? Be respectful. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? All right. You have your hand up? Mm-hmm. I like that. Don't laugh. If people falls down, help them to get up. Give you food. Listen, that's on my list. I love to eat. It may not be noticeable, but I love to eat. Give you lunch. Be on the same page. Okay. And so, what do you do to take care of yourself? What do you like to do for yourself? Anybody wants to share one thing that you do that's good for you? Yeah, take care of yourself. Take a bath. Skin care. Buy food. We on the same page again. Buy food. Anyone else? Study for a test. Mm-hmm. So you help yourself get good grades. Respect yourself and love yourself. Make money. Good. Mm-hmm. Respect your teachers. Do your homework. Do your homework. Now, raise your hand if you feel as though you do some of these things or most of these things for other people. Oh, hold on. What happened? You don't share your food? Okay. I kind of get it. Let me ask that again because y'all don't look too sure. Raise your hand if you do some of these things for other people. Okay. Okay, that's a little better. Let me clap for y'all because that looked like that was hard for y'all to say just now. Okay. Have y'all heard of the part in the Bible that says, love your neighbor as you love yourself? Do you think that the same things you do for yourself or that you would want done for yourself, you should practice doing it for others? You say only a mommy? Let's widen that, please. That's okay? Okay. All right. Our neighbors are others. And I noticed when we were listing what we like for ourselves, it had to do with respect, getting help, love, and so forth. So what I want us to do, when we think about others, the word others, who would be our neighbors, remember these acronyms whenever we see people, okay, and repeat it after me. The word other stands for this. O is for offer. T, time. H, help. E, encouragement. R, respect. S, smiles. Whenever we think of others, offer your time, help, encouragement, respect, and smiles. Do you think that you'll remember that every time you come across other people or your neighbors, people around you? Can you remember to say that back to me? Let's see if you remember. What does the word other stand for? Ooh, y'all must make 4.0 in school. Y'all get that on one go. Give them a clap. They got it. Okay? All right, so love others as you would love yourself. And just what you want for yourself, Think about it. It's the time, health, encouragement. You want respect and you want happiness, okay? So let's give that to others. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you for everything that you do for us, the way that you love us, the things that you give to us, Father. Father, help us to give those things to other people. Always be wonderful. Help us to be wonderful and kind to our neighbors, O God. Father God, just bring us closer to you, O God, and continue to give us a spirit like yours so that we can do and show your light to others. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, you all can go back to your seats. Thank you. We will now have our scripture readings. The first one will be done by Mr. Allison Underwood, and the second would be by Mrs. Jessie Underwood.
First scripture lesson is from Leviticus chapter 19. Verses 1 and 2, and then 15 through 18. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the entire assembly of Israel and say to them, 'Be holy because I, Lord your God, am holy. Each of you must respect your mother and father. You must observe my Sabbath. I am the Lord your God.'" Verse 15, "Do not pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbor fairly. Don't go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Do not hate your brother in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so that he will not share in his guilt. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against one of your people, but love your neighbor as you do love yourself. I am the Lord." Here endeth the first lesson.
Everyone, I just want to say that song was really rewarding. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. That's a beautiful thing to be able to say. Now, the reading this comes from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 22, verses 32 to 44. "I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living." And when the multitude heard this, they were astonished at his doctrine. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, "Master, which is the great commandment in the law?" Jesus said unto him, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?" They say unto him, "The son of David." He saith unto them, How then does David in spirit call him Lord, saying, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. Thanks be to God for the reading of his word. Amen.
We will now be blessed with a solo by Mr. Allison Underwood.
I have a birthday coming up soon. And you know, I am really blessed that over these years, I have a voice to sing, and my voice is still holding up. And that I am glad. Gia sang a song at a funeral the other day, and you listen to the religious stations, radio stations, you'll hear this song all the time. To show how blessed we are. All my life, I have been faithful. All my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will praise and sing of the goodness of God. And you know, the song I'm about to sing is a song of praise. It's a song about the morning. And the morning has just broken. And the other couple of weeks ago, we had some dew that fell heavily in the morning. And I said, wow, this feels so nice outside this morning. So I sing this song now. Mic went off momentarily. Thank you.
God.
Thank you, Mr. Underwood, for blessing us with that lovely selection and reminding us of the goodness of God. As we prepare and open our hearts and our minds to receive the sermon, let us sing our hymn of faith, My Jesus, I Love Thee, hymn number 437.
Good morning. Where did the time go? I thought I had plenty of time because I got plenty of sheets here, right? A whole heap of sheets. I just wanted to say when I was coming here, I was reflecting on when I first came to Ebenezer some 65 years ago. I would say I was among the lower 20% in age, maybe 10, but let's put it to 20. And I suddenly realized I'm now in the top 10% of the top scale. And so what does that say? We're getting old, right? Yeah, we're getting old, but we're glad to be here. And we're glad to see the people who are older than me here. I know a few, but some of you may look younger than what you are, so I would be down on the count. In any case, it's good to be here. And I thought in opening up, I was thinking, I appreciated Sister Gia's talk on the, you know, being good neighbor, thinking of others. And I know it's tomorrow is the day before Halloween, so I thought I put something together that I thought maybe the children would listen to, right? These are very brief jokes, if you like. And why did the mother witch have problem with her twin witches? She didn't know which witch was which. Why did the witch use a broomstick to get away? She wanted to make a clean getaway. When her broomstick broke, how did she get where she was going? Or he? She witch-hiked. Now that was witches. Now why did Cinderella not make a good football player? Somebody should know that one. She had a pumpkin for a coach. And how did the jack-o'-lantern get fixed when it broke? It used a pumpkin patch. And why are graveyards noisy? Because of all the coffin. What do dentists give out for Halloween? Candy. It's good for business. Now, the next one is a knock knock. And I know the children know knock knock, right? Knock knock, who's there? Ice cream. I scream when I see a ghost. One more knock. Knock knock. Witch. Which one took my candy? Anyway, we're nearly finished. What is the ghost's favorite food? Spookgetty. Wow. Spookgetty. Why do witches not wear flat hats? There's no point to it. Wow. Where does Dracula keep his money? The blood bank. And why did the skeleton go to the barbecue? He wanted a spare rib. Okay, so much for the, maybe that's enough humor. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Amen. Now this morning, the text says, we're looking at who is my neighbor, but our general theme, when we talk about neighbors, the general theme has to be love, because we have to love our neighbors. And in the New Testament lesson that we read about, it says the Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and they, let's put it this way, they were not sincere in what they were asking. They were trying to trick him and see if they could trap him. And let's say, before we go into that, Jesus came back to them at the end and said, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? And they said, well, he's the son of David. Jesus said, but how could he be the son of David if David said, my Lord said to my Lord, sit on my right hand till your enemies, and so forth. He said, how could you be the son if he had been there before him? If then David called him Lord, how could he be his son? And we're told that they couldn't say anything after that. I just say that to say that sometimes Jesus, when he's asked a question, he will always come back with another question to sort of clarify it. But this lawyer came, and while we're on lawyers, they were in court, and the prosecution lawyer and the defense lawyer were having a real verbal brawl, if you like. And finally, the prosecution lawyer called the defense lawyer, said, you ain't nothing but a dirty, lousy thief. And so he answered back, well, you ain't nothing but a dirty, lousy liar. The judge wrapped his gavel and said, "Now that the lawyers have identified themselves, let's get on with the case." So this lawyer comes to Jesus, and we're going to merge the two. There's another story about a lawyer who came and asked Jesus, not what is the greatest commandment, but what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus' answer in both cases was pretty similar. He said, you have to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And then the second one, the one we read today, didn't include strength, but in the one where he told the parable of the Good Samaritan, he included strength. And so he said, that's the first commandment. You have to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so that, I think what Jesus was telling them, this involves every part of our being, if you like. First of all, you have to love God with all your heart. What is your heart? We think your heart is a pump that pumps blood through your body, right? That's the description, but we think of it as being the center of our emotions. And I know all of us, when we get excited, generally you grab for your heart, right? If you have a bad news or something or other. So it's sort of the center of our feelings. Now, some ancient cultures had other organs. I think some said your liver was the center of your being and whatnot. But we think of our heart as being where our feelings are, what we feel, and with all of our soul. And our soul is something that we can't quite put our finger on. Our soul is that immortal part that doesn't die, that lives on. And I was reading an article the other day, and they were trying to say that they tried to establish how much does our soul weigh. Now, I don't know what kind of way they determined it. I imagine they must have weighed somebody before they died and then after they died. But they determined the soul weighed something like 3/4 of an ounce or some small amount anyway. But that our soul is something we can't put our finger on. Now our mind is the logical part of our being, if you like, the thing that plans things. And sometimes our heart, our mind and our heart don't always work together. Our heart may tell us to do one thing, but our mind tells us the other. I like to think that we should listen to our heart rather than our mind, you know, because sometimes you may get a call to do something, right? Your heart will tell you God is telling you to do it. Your mind will tell you all of the difficulties that can come up if you try to do it. It's not going to work. It can't be done, blah, blah. So sometimes we have to listen to our heart rather than our mind. And then the last one, which is mentioned in Luke 10, with all of our strength. And as I was thinking of that, you know, we have heart, soul, and mind are sort of abstract. But if we don't put into action, you know, but I think of the strength as being putting it into action. You know, you need to put into action the things that you're called to do. So Jesus said, you have to love God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. But now we're going to look at, we have to love our neighbor as ourselves. Now, in the Old Testament we read, and a couple of verses we didn't read, that was just before it, says the things or the way you're to treat your neighbor the way, the things you're to do or to not to do to your neighbor. Defraud not your neighbor. Don't crook your neighbor. It says, do not curse the deaf. I don't know about you, but I find people are not too sympathetic to the deaf. They're sympathetic to those in a wheelchair, with a walker, with a stick, or if they can't see. But when they speak to you and you don't answer, what am you deaf, eh? I've had that all my life, right? There seems to be no sympathy for the deaf. But anyway, it just says don't curse them. Or put a stumbling block ahead of the blind. Do not pervert justice. In other words, don't interfere with justice. And I'm reminded of another story that I read about a man was walking through the park, and he looks over on the side and he sees there's a tall fella about 6'6" or whatever, and there's this little short fella, not more than 5 feet. And both of them are holding on to this wallet. So he jumps in and beats up the old fella, the tall fella, and the little fella gets the wallet, runs away, and the big fella says, thank you very much. You helped that fella steal my wallet. You know, and that gets a message for me. Sometimes we're very quick to jump in when we really don't know the situation. So the best thing, if you don't know, stay out of it. What's our old Calypso song? Oh, never interfere with man and wife. You never understand, no matter who is wrong or who is right, just offer sympathy, right? If we don't know, let's keep out of it. It says, and this part I found, it said, do not be partial to the poor. Most of us want to jump in on the side of the poor, right? Because we feel they've been disadvantaged. But what they're saying, justice is justice. Don't take somebody's part just because they're poor. You may, you know, have to support them. And then it says, do not be partial either to the rich. But generally in our society, we discard the rich. We say they got everything. They don't need nothing. There are a lot of rich people who need friends, right? Who need, you know, we'll get down to neighborly and whatever later. But sometimes we can't always see just by coming in. Judge fairly. Don't slander. Another word is gossip. We love to gossip. We like to find out, but we say we like to hear the news, right? Getting the news is a little different from spreading gossip, right? But I just, you know, sometimes we need to know what's going on, but, and do not seek revenge or bear grudges. And that's one of the things that we sometimes, or I sometimes, find hard to do. When somebody hurts you, it's difficult not to bear some little resentment, but it needs working on not to bear a grudge or resentment. Now we get down to the point of who is our neighbor? Now, who is our neighbor? Is it the person across the street? The person next door? Yes, I guess they're our neighbor as well. Now some of us, including myself, we don't know the people who live next door or down the road or across the street. And then we say, and I say, you know, one of my neighbors have pit bulls in the yard, right? I you know, I hesitate to go around dogs. Other neighbors have gates. You can't get in unless you go yell for them to come out, and you know. We seem to have cut ourselves off in a way, but we could do more, right? We could do more to treat the neighbors who are our neighbors as neighbors. Now, in the story of the The Good Samaritan in the story of the Good Samaritan, we're told about, Jesus told the story to illustrate, because the lawyer had asked, and you know, lawyers keep asking questions. He had asked, you know, who is my neighbor? And so Jesus told the story to illustrate it. Now, we don't know who this man was. We're told he was going from Jerusalem to Jericho, and generally, in theological terms, they say, well, Jerusalem was God's city. Jericho was a cursed city, so the man was on the downward trend. We don't know all of that, but we don't know who he was. Was he a rich man? And, you know, he was robbed. Was he a poor man? Was he a thief himself? And he got robbed. We don't know. We have a saying with us, when teeth from teeth, God laugh, right? But we don't know who he was, but his character is irrelevant to the story that Jesus was telling. And then we have the Levite and the priest and the Levite who come, and again they have a sort of different attitude. They come afterwards. Sorry, I missed about them getting beaten up. But and the thieves, and someone has said that the thing is, the thief, his belief was, what you have is mine. Now the Pharisee, the priest and the Levite, their feeling was, what is mine, and I'm going to keep it, right? And so they just walked by on the other side. And I'm sure they had excuse there. We had in there's a little children's videos, Veggie Tales, I think it was, yeah. And the feast, the priest and the Levite are singing, I'm busy, I'm busy, I'm terribly busy. I don't have time for all of this, you know, to be involved in these things. And we can have the same excuse sometimes. I'm too busy to stop and help. And I always think, if you meet somebody with a flat tire and you're on the way to church, and you're going to say, but I got to get to church, or in my case, I could say, I got to preach, right? Is that an excuse, right? Not to help somebody who's in need, or particularly if they got to go to hospital or whatever. But I think you understand what I mean. Sometimes we can make too many excuses. But the Samaritan, he said, what is mine is yours, right? And that's the attitude that I think Jesus was trying to get across. Now, Jesus comes and he asks the lawyer, now which one do you think is the neighbor to the man who fell among the thieves? And he said, well, I guess it's the one who helped him. But go back a little further, you know, who was the one who helped him? The one who helped him was his enemy, right? He was not a friend. You know, a lot of us will help friends if we see friends' need, but if it's a perfect stranger, not quite so much. Now, and someone was saying, well, it doesn't, like, your own family and friends, true, they are our neighbors, but sometimes is it easy to help them? Sometimes they get on our nerves too, right? You know, sometimes we wonder if they're our enemies, right? Because sometimes they do things, or we do things to them, and we get all upset. But Jesus said, you have to love your enemies. And I think he brings the point out here with this Samaritan. We, from the story, we understand the man who was beat up was a Jew, so it was his own people wouldn't stop to help him. But this foreigner, this person who he had been taught from childhood to hate, is the person who helped him, came and helped him. Now I want to finish by saying categorically that everybody is our neighbor. It's no use to say, now again, I don't know, there's no word, such word, the neighbory or the neighbor-or, right? You know, you being the good neighbor or being the one who is being helped. And so if you look at it, anybody who needs our help is our neighbor. And again, if we help them, then we are their neighbor, whatever the situation may have been before. Now I have, the sermon is just about there, but just a word on love. You know, we have to learn to love, how shall we say, to help people because we love them. And love doesn't have to be like. I think some people can be annoying enough that you may dislike them, but you still have to love them. Love is action. Love is not just words. And I don't know if I should say this. I get, maybe today we hear too much, I love you, I love you, I love you, love you every time on the phone or wherever and whatever. And I think sometimes if we use something too much, it gets not to mean anything. And that's why I think that the Jewish people way back, they wouldn't say God's name because they didn't want it to be common. But I have to give this last story before we go. There was a young man who was declaring his love for his lady friend, and he called her on the phone and he told her, well, you know, I'd do anything for you. I'd swim the highest mountain, swim the deepest river, cross the widest, deepest ocean, walk across the burning desert in my bare feet. All of this I will do for you. And just to remind you, I'll be coming to see you on Tuesday if it doesn't rain. And you know, sometimes we're like that. We love people until we find that they need something for us. And then we tend to back off, right? It may not be quite what we want. But let's just remember that who is my neighbor? My neighbor is everyone that I meet. We might not be able to. We won't reach the whole world of 8 million people. But there are the people we pass day by day. And we could even give a good morning, good afternoon. Some people will look at you and like you're crazy because people don't do that no more, right? Good morning, Mrs. Smith. Good morning, Mr. Jones, whatever. But I think we should do it anyway. And you know, sometimes speaking to, just speak to them. And I found this yesterday. I saw somebody with a sign on the, which said, I'm having a good day. Don't ruin it, you know. And I spoke to him. I said, I like you. And he laughed, you know. And if you can get somebody to smile, that works something, you know. So let's remember, whoever we meet, they're our neighbors. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we pray that you will help us, Lord, to love our neighbors. And we know by loving our neighbors, that means loving our enemies as well. And you taught us, you taught your disciples and us, that we have to love our enemies, do good for them who hurt us, and whatever the case may be, Lord, do not hold any grudges or any animosity to any other human being. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we thank Mr. Earl Pender for that message, I would like to show that I paid special attention to the message and point out just a few things that stood out to me, if that's okay. Based on the message I gathered and what stuck out when he said, strength is to put in action things we are called to do. That can be so hard, and that takes strength. Two, He reminded us to be mindful of how we treat others and their situations. 3, offer our neighbors the same love and respect, no matter who is who. 4, treat others as we would want to be treated or as we treat ourselves. 5, our neighbors would be anyone around us, anyone we come in contact with. And 6, love each other no matter what, even if we don't like everything about them. So I was paying special attention to every point. So can we turn to our neighbors to our left and our right and say, I love you.
I love you. I love you.
So thank you, Mr. Pinder. So as we close our service today, we just want to thank you, thank everyone who was here, everyone who's tuned in and who's been involved, and we hope that you were touched in a special way. Our closing hymn is Help Us to Help Each Other, Lord. Hymn number 717, verse 1 to 3. Let us say our mission statement together. To worship God joyfully, offer Christ faithfully, promote growth hopefully, serve others lovingly.
And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with each of us and all those we love, and all of God's people throughout our world, throughout this day and forevermore. Amen.